Hello everyone. In the last video, we have seen how we can enroll for the RPA Developer Certificate in UiPath. In this video, we can specifically talk about the advanced training section. So because this is a level 3 advanced training, we have to submit two assignments. So the first assignment I think would be common for all of you, which is nothing but calculate security hash code. So the steps will be pretty much easy and you will be given this PDF detailing every single step what we need to be doing it. And it is a good practice to do it with the RE framework. And even if you're not following the RE framework, as long as your code is able to generate the hash code, you can still submit it and then that will be verified. So because the basic check here, they will verify only the hash code. If it matches with your profile and if they find that your match code, your hash code is matching with the existing hash code, which are mapped to your profile, then it is a tick mark. So you'll get passed. So that's it. Let's get started the challenges part. So in automating this process, I'm sure that you may encounter one or all of these challenges. What are the challenges? So you may face a challenge to understand how to navigate to a specific work item. So when we'll go with the real application and see what are we talking about. And you may face a challenge how to get the client details. And third one will be how to handle two different windows. So let's go and understand from an application point of view what is the process is all about. So the process is to log into this application and go to the work items and click on filter only by the WiFi type by default, because it is a first time, until otherwise you don't reset the value, it will be always in open status. And we need to filter by WiFi and navigate to that work item. We will be clicking this button. This will navigate to the work item. And we need to go get all of this client ID. For example, we need to get this client ID and append this with hyphen in between client ID, client name, hyphen, and then this France, right? Append this with ID and then go to another website, which is called SKCA1. And then we need to go generate a hash code for this ID. So this will be unique. And even if you put a space here, and this value won't be same. For example, I'll show you a demo. For example, if I go here and put this value, and if there is a space in between, if I generate the hash code now, and you will see a all brand new different ID. So that's a catch, right? If they see that whatever database UiPath is having this hash code, and if you are able to generate only this, then it is a fail, right? So that we need to be careful about trimming all of the variables. So we see how we can do it. And once we get that ID, we need to copy and go back to this application, click update work item, and we need to get this hash code here, copy it and change the status to completed and click it and come out of this window. So it's pretty simple. How do we do it from the UiPath Studio? I hope that if you are following the previous video, I don't think there will be any challenges. The main challenge is what we are talking about now, right? So the first challenge, how to navigate to a specific work item. If I go back here and there is no link test, right? For example, if I click on WiFi, it's not a clickable element. So the only way we can go here is to click this particular button. But this button, as you can see on the page, it's not a unique button. It doesn't have any unique ID, right? You can confirm that by going to that particular element and you see that there is a class attribute, which would be common for all. If I put this class attribute here, right, you are finding it 10 different things. So how do we filter it, right? So it may not be the case. So we need to get it from the data table and then we need to instruct go to this particular work item. So if you can carefully watch this URL is here. If I click the particular WiFi button, it changes to this value, right? What is get changed? There is a forward slash plus the WiID, right? This is an ID. And we know that part of our previous process, we would have got this WiID as an outcome, right? So if you are able to append that URL with this one, then our first challenge is done, correct? So how do we do from a scripting point of view? Sorry, from the process point of view, if I go and pull it, attach browser, and there is an activity called navigate one. So we need to attach the browzer. This is not a browser we'll be attaching because we will be landing here first thing, right? This is our landing page. If I go and attach it, and we need to change it to Chrome. And within that attached browser, within that window, there is a navigate to activity which will ask us to navigate to a specific URL. We know how we can frame that specific URL. This is the URL, base URL, and we need to append this with forward slash and then plus the WIID, right? So if the previous process or previous sequence is able to generate this WIID, and if you put this step, it is going to directly navigate to the specific URL. But for our example now, let me hard code this value and say whatever value that we wanted to navigate to. So this is the WIID, and I'm going to copy this one and put it in this where, this string, right? So if I run this program now, and it is going to navigate to the specific work item. Yes, so we are here. So this is our first objective, correct? So we can achieve this through the navigate to activity. So our first challenge is done. Let's move to the second challenge. Let's keep this one attached browser again, or maybe we can get the next one. The next challenge would be how to get this client information, client ID, client name, and then country. Because of the challenge, why I'm saying it is a challenge, because if you right click and inspect it, we cannot identify every single text as an individual element. It comes as a paragraph tag, right? And you can only get only the client ID, client name, and client country as a text separated. But that's not what we want. We need the client actual values, right? So in order to do that, there are different ways you can try and do it. One other way we have not covered so far is to get it from the OCR engine. So there is a method called get OCR text. If I pull this one and indicate this on the screen, and you can select that only the client ID is what I need, right? And it is going to return us something, the text, and then we can save the text, and then we can manipulate the string to get this ID. That's a one way, but I wouldn't prefer that because it may be sometimes flaky. For example, if there is some letter, it may convert into a number. For example, O will be converted to 0, something like that. So we'll not get an accurate answer. As a result of that, you may get an incorrect hash code, correct? So that's not preferred. What is the other option then? So other option is to do with the string manipulation. How do we do that? So basically we can get this client ID as a get text. Yes, let's do that. If I put get text, so get text is going to return us all of this text within this paragraph, right? Because it's treated as a single element. If I indicate this one and go to this entire get text, and if I save this value, because remember that this is not a string output, it's a type of out argument. So we need to save it as a control K. Let me save this as retrieved string. Or it's a retrieved str, whatever, whichever name suits you, right? If I save this one, and is it not generated? No, we didn't put, we created something different. So let me create that again, copy that, control K, and put that value, the same value, right? Let's see whether it is created. Yes, so this is created now. And next step, so as a result of this activity, we're going to get the retrieved text in the paragraph format. So with the help of string manipulation, we can get individual element. So how do we do that? Because any expression in UiPath Studio, we are going to use the assigned element. So if I pull assign, and we know what we get from this activity, that's nothing but retrieved string. If I try to edit this value, we know that retrieved string is a string already. And it's not a string, it's generic type, because it's not specifying that it is a string, right? So there's a split function or method. If I put split method, if I put a double quote and then there's a colon. So why I'm putting this colon, double quote and all? Because if you look at this element carefully, if we find a way to separate individual element by this colon, then we will get a different element, right? So by using the split method, it's going to return us the right side of that one. This will be a separate element, and until the other colon, it will be a separate element, and this will be a separate element, and finally the country. So we'll get four elements from this, right? If we're able to split that. So that's what we are trying to do. If I split by colon, and if you want to understand this function very clearly, put this colon, and there are four overloading methods. You can navigate one by one and see what is the difference. It can accept as a string. it can accept as a character as well. Parameter array, we can pass it in array also. We can pass an array as a separator, as a character. Second method overloading is to, we can pass it as a separator as a string. So you can understand that. So our primary objective here is to separate this with the help of colon. If you do that, and it's going to return a string, but that's what we have seen, but it is ideally a string array, right? Because it is written more than one value. So let's save this as str array, right? And we need to change the type of str array to actually the, not from a generic, it should be an array of string. We know that what is the content, the members of the string, right? So it's going to store as a string. So let's verify and try to print every single element and see whether what we thought is correct or not. So how do we iterate with more than one element? Basically, there is a for each activity, and for each we pull it here, and then what is that array or collection? So the array that we have is string array, and we'll collect, consider individual item as an object. By default, it is saving as an object, but inside this array, we know what elements are there. It is nothing but we know inside everything there is a string element. We can directly modify also. And if I try to console this out or try to write line, what we're going to see here is, if I try to print this item, because already item is a string, so it's going to print us. So let's see what is getting printed, right? If I run this code now, let's ensure that the page is open. Yes, if I run it, it's completed. If you look at the output is what we thought, right? So it's going to print the client ID separated and this value separated, because that's how it is separated by this colon. This third value and this is the fourth value. So we get a four values. But is it what we need? We need only the client ID, which is in the second index, right? Because any array starts with zero. So second index, what we are interested in. And next index. So what is that we can think of now? If there is a way we can replace the client name in the second index, if we replace the client name with the blank value, then we will get only the second value, right? That's a one way. So how do we do that? Again, we need to any expression UiPath, again, there is a assign activity, correct? If I put assign activity just above the for each loop, and we know that what is the string array we know, and we also know how we can access a string element. So if I put string array, the index that we are talking about is one index, index number one. And if I put replace, what we are trying to replace the client name. For example, if I get only the client name, and it's going to search for that value. Replace this client name, right? Space can be there with the blank value. If I put double quote, it's a blank value. So what it's going to do, it's going to replace this particular, it's going to find out the index number one and replace this one. As a result of that one, we are going to get a string again, right? Replaced string. If I control K and then place, this is actually the client ID, right? That is a string. Client ID is a string. Let's modify that. Okay. And again, it is going to return a string. We need to trim it also because there will be a space. If I put it trim method as again, and this is what it is. If I go and try to console this out, if I put a right line, and then we are trying to put the client ID, we are going to get the client ID is, maybe just for our reference, let me put the client ID is plus client ID, right? Just for the differentiation. So if I run it now, and if I go here, the client ID is what we value that expected. So it's great, right? So that's what we need. So once we are able to retrieve it, and then we know how to manipulate and how we can concatenate one string from another, and then we can put a string separated, adding a hyphen in between, and we can frame it. So that's a tedious job, I would say, because we need to put a lot more steps. But instead of that, there's an easy way we can do it with the same string array function. Instead of this place, if I go have a look at it, this one where we are splitting, there are different split overload method we have seen, right? So imagine that I wanted to separate with the colon, and let's also think of separating the client, because the client is the name everywhere is there. If there is a way I can separate this entire paragraph into by the client as well as the colon, and I will get only the unique ID, right? I will get a client and then I will get ID, this one, name, right? Anything outside of the client, right? So if I add one more separator, for example, one more regex, right? And that's going to give us only the unique value, ID, the ID value, name, this value, country, this value, right? Except that one. So how do we do that? We have already seen a overloading method. What we are trying to do is again put another array inside and say that separate this when you find a colon, comma, separate this when you find a client as well. This means that whenever it is going to find a colon, whenever it is going to find a client, it is going to separate and put it as a different array. So if we close this one, and there is a option as well. So we have put it already. And if you just scroll down, there is a string split option also, right? If I put, because that's a enum, string split option. And if you put a dot, we have a method or we have a property called remove empty entries. So what is, if there is a empty entry, it's going to remove that as well, right? So with this line of code, we have even simplified the code. What is going to do? It's going to find if there is the entire paragraph, it's going to find if there is a colon, if there is a client, it's going to separate and put it as a different values in the array, right? So this array will be much more fine-tuned if I put this code now, and we do not have to replace it, and we do not have to do that. In the same array, if we try to print the element now, we will see the different thing. We will see one by one, one element by another, which is very fine-tuned one, right? So we are seeing the first thing. First is blank, second one is ID, third one is the actual ID value, name, this name, country, and France. So if I consider this entire thing as an array, starting with index 0, index 0 is blank, index 1 is ID, which I don't need, index 2 is what we need, right? If I get index 2, and this is 3 and 4, index 4, this is 5 and 6. If I get 2, 4, and 6, that is what the string we need, correct? So this then we will be able to frame this one exactly, correct? So how do we get that? Because we know that this retrieved string split will give an array. If I go to the array here, and this easy simple way we can do it instead of getting it printed, because every expression here we will be writing it in the assign activity, put the assign thing here, and we will write a single line. So how do we write it? Because we know the what is the string array, and we also seen what is the index that we are interested in. The index is 2, and if you put a trim, because it's going to trim if there is any white space before or in the end, right? And we need to append this with the hyphen, because that is a requirement. So how do we append it? We know how we can append the string manipulation, I mean string concatenation, put hyphen in between, and plus, and we need to get three values, right? So if I copy this one and put one more, plus we need to append with hyphen again, plus this value. What is the index we are interested in? Index 2 and index 4 and index 6. So if we are able to get the string, that is a string we need to search for. If I put this as control K, search string. Let me change the search string value to a string. Cool. So it's just a one line code. It's going to give us exactly what we need. So let's go and print and see whether what we need. If I go it here, it's going to pull us, and we have not console, we have not printed. That's why there is no value. So let's put the right line. And if I put it here, what we are trying to get it is the search string. So if I print this one, save it and run it. And if I go here, this is exactly what we need. If I copy this value and if I put it in my notepad, just to see whether the value that we expected is correct or not, right? It's exactly the same thing. So we will not miss anything. And if I put the same string into the other website, and if I get the string value, then we are good. So we need to just go to the other website and put this value, and whatever hash that we're creating will be exactly matched with the database of UiPath. So then the test result will be passed, right? So this one thing. So this is second challenge that we talked about, how to get the client details. Third thing would be, in the event when you wanted to update the record in this page, update work item, you see a pop-up kind of a window, a separate window. So sometimes UiPath may find, because if you look at the title also, this window's title and the parent window titles remain same. So it may not be able to identify that. So the easiest way you can solve this problem is, if I pull the screen for you, just show you an idea. For example, if I go and get attached browser, if I try to point to the child browser, for example, if I just try to attach this and change it to Chrome, let's look at the selector. What is the selector there? And there is a attribute called HTML window name, which is nothing but WI update. So it was not there in the previous, couple of months back. So then now they added an additional attribute. So by this time, I think it will identify the unique value. But if you still face any challenges, the easiest way you can separate this is from other attributes. You need to add additional attribute called IDX. So in UiPath terminology, the IDX is nothing but index. In case of more than one value, the index will separate which value we are looking at. It's just like any other attribute. We need to put a single quote and then say element is 2, right? Because if it finds 2 index, it's going to handle the second index. Or if it is dealing with 0, then you may need to put 1, right? I think the index starts from 0 here in this particular context. So we'll put 0, right? Sorry, we'll put 2. So this means that it is going to find the same title of the window, but it will go and identify the second aspect of it in case it finds more than one window. So this is how we can save it and then handle the different other windows as well. So that will be easy. So once we launch this window, and we need to enter this value and close this one. So closing that window, there is an activity called close window, right? This will work for browser as well. If you put a close window and then indicate that window, it's going to close that window. And this is how we achieve that, the client security hash code, the process flow. So it'll be very straightforward. If you follow the previous videos, how we can get the data table, how we can convert into a filtered data table and go one by one for each method, and that will be very easy. And it is a good practice if you are following the RE framework to complete this assignment. Even if you're not able to do it, if you're able to generate the right hash code, and if you're able to upload that code, then you will get this code. You will get a pass certificate in advanced training, right? So this is the other way. But in the final exam, in the final RPA developer certificate, you are required to go with only the RE framework, right? So we'll see in the next video how we can use, what is the different components of RE framework, how we can use it effectively. And we can also see the solution of the entire assignments, right? Until then, thanks for watching. If you like the content of the video, again, you can subscribe to this channel. Thanks for watching again.